Random House Audiobooks presents Lewis and Clark, The Journey of the Core of Discovery by Dayton Duncan and Ken Burns. Read by a full cast featuring Ken Burns as narrator and Adam Arkin as Meriwether Lewis.
Lewis and Clark, The Journey of the Core of Discovery.
Honored parents, I now embrace this opportunity of writing to let you know where I am and where I am going. I am well, thank God, and in high spirits. I am now on an expedition to the westward with Captain Lewis and Captain Clark, who were appointed by the President of the United States to go through the interior parts of North America. We are to ascend the Missouri River with a boat as far as it is navigable and then go by land to the Western Ocean, if nothing prevents. We expect to be gone 18 months or 2 years. We are to receive a great reward for this expedition when we return. I am to receive $15 per month and at least 400 acres of first-rate land, and if we make great discoveries as we expect, the United States has promised to make us great rewards. For fear of accidents, I wish to inform you that I left $200 in cash at Kaskaskias, and if I should not live to return, my heirs can get that and all the pay due me from the U.S. government. I will write next winter if I have a chance. Sergeant John Ordway.
One afternoon in the spring of 1804, in a heavily loaded keelboat and two oversized canoes, nearly four dozen men crossed the Mississippi River and started up the Missouri, struggling against its thick, muddy current. They were on the most important expedition in American history, the United States' first official exploration into unknown spaces, and a glimpse into their young nation's future. They would become the first United States citizens to experience the Great Plains, the immensity of its skies, the rich splendor of its wildlife, the harsh rigors of its winters. They would be the first American citizens to see the daunting peaks of the Rocky Mountains, the first to struggle over them, the first to cross the continental divide to where the rivers flow west. And after encountering cold, hunger, danger, and wonders beyond belief, they would become the first of their nation to reach the Pacific Ocean by land. It would be the greatest adventure of their lives.
The best authenticated accounts informed us that we were to pass through a country possessed by numerous, powerful, and warlike nations of savages, of gigantic stature, fierce, treacherous, and cruel, and particularly hostile to white men. Sergeant Patrick Gass.
They carried the most modern weapons of their time, but in their two moments of greatest need, women would intervene on their behalf. And time again, they would be saved by the kindness of strangers. They told people who had been occupying the land for hundreds of generations that the West now belonged to someone else. Yet they would meet more friends than enemies, and only once fire their guns in anger. They were led by two utterly different men who, representing a new nation that celebrated individual achievement, would rely instead on cooperation and teamwork. They called themselves the Core of Discovery, yet they would fail to find the thing they had been sent most of all to discover. Their real discovery would be the land itself and the promises it held.
However our present interests may restrain us within our own limits, it is impossible not to look forward to distant times when our rapid multiplication will expand itself beyond those limits and cover the whole continent, with a people speaking the same language, governed in similar forms, and by similar laws. Thomas Jefferson.
When Thomas Jefferson became president in 1801, two out of every three Americans lived within 50 miles of the Atlantic Ocean. Only four roads crossed the Allegheny Mountains. The United States ended on the eastern banks of the Mississippi River. To the southwest, stretching from Texas to California, lay New Spain. England controlled Canada. Its traders were expanding southward into what is now Minnesota and the Dakotas for valuable furs. and its ships were dominating the Pacific Northwest. Russia, with outposts in Alaska, would soon erect a fort on the northern coast of California. And from the Mississippi to the Rocky Mountains was the vast French territory called Louisiana, where Napoleon Bonaparte hoped to reestablish an empire in the New World. But while many nations dreamed of controlling the West's destiny, they still knew very little about the place itself. No one was more anxious to change that than the new president, Thomas Jefferson. Though he had never traveled more than 50 miles west of Virginia's Shenandoah Valley, Jefferson had always been fascinated by the West. His personal library at Monticello contained more books about the region than any other library in the world. Some of them told him that woolly mammoths and other prehistoric animals still roamed there. Others described erupting volcanoes and a mountain of pure salt 180 miles long and 45 miles wide. Based on his reading, Jefferson believed that Virginia's Blue Ridge Mountains might be the continent's highest, and that somewhere in the West was a tribe of blue-eyed Indians who spoke Welsh, descendants of a fabled Prince Madoc who supposedly had settled in the New World 3 centuries before Columbus. Above all, like everyone else at the time, Jefferson believed in the Northwest Passage, a river or a series of rivers connected by a short portage that would cross the Western Mountains, make direct trade with the Orient easier and more profitable, and unlock the wealth of North America. Whichever nation discovered the Northwest Passage and then controlled it, Jefferson believed, would control the destiny of the continent. For more than a century, the Spanish, French, and British had been searching for the passage. 3 times, Jefferson himself had tried to organize American expeditions to find it, each time in vain. Now, as president, Jefferson decided to try once more.
January 18, 1803, confidential. Gentlemen of the Senate and of the House of Representatives, the River Missouri and the Indians inhabiting it are not as well known as is rendered desirable. It is, however, understood that the country on that river is inhabited by numerous tribes who furnish great supplies of furs. An intelligent officer with 10 or 12 chosen men might explore the whole line, even to the Western Ocean. The appropriation of $2,500 would cover the undertaking. Thomas Jefferson.
In a secret message to Congress to win its support, Jefferson emphasized the potential commercial benefits of the expedition. But he told the ambassadors from France, Spain, and England, whose territories would be crossed, that it would be a purely scientific expedition. The British and French ambassadors wrote out passports assuring safe conduct. Distrustful of American motives, the Spanish declined, but Jefferson simply ignored their objections. At last, in early 1803, Jefferson's persistent dream of exploring the West for the sake of science, commerce, and the national interest seemed about to be fulfilled.
Captain Lewis is brave, prudent, habituated to the woods, and familiar with Indian manners and character. He is not regularly educated, but he possesses a great mass of accurate observation on all the subjects of nature which present themselves. Thomas Jefferson. February 28, 1803.
To lead what he called his Corps of Discovery, the president turned to his personal secretary, Meriwether Lewis. Lewis had grown up in Jefferson's own Albemarle County, the serious-minded son of a planter who had died during the Revolution when Lewis was only 5. By age 16, he was responsible for the welfare of his mother, brothers, and sisters. At 18, he eagerly volunteered for Jefferson's ill-fated Michaux expedition, but was turned down. Instead, the young Lewis had joined the regular army on the frontiers of western Pennsylvania and Ohio and made a name for himself as a promising officer before Jefferson brought him to Washington in 1801. There, as the new president's sole aide, he drew up a list of army commanders who could be expected to be loyal to the new administration, copied presidential documents, ran errands, and set up residence in what is now.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.